Mondo 2000 grew out of science fiction, really. I didn't really get an introduction that explained what Mondo 2000 is. I was expecting that. Y'all, how many people here know Mondo 2000? Okay, so some of you know. Anyway, in the early 1990s, we published what was called a cyberpunk magazine. That's what we referred it to. Right here is a copy of it, and actually there are some copies here that you can buy if you don't mind me making a little commercial here. But Mondo was sort of the predecessor to Wire magazine, but a lot more anarchic, a lot more playful, a lot more ridiculous. I mean, there's the assumption that if you put a cover on something and squeeze a bunch of pages in between a cover, that what you do has to be journalism. And actually, it's just a medium. It's, you know, like any other object, video, film, whatever. You can do anything you want with it. And what Mondo did, and we really use this term, which is great for tonight, we really did think of it as science faction, a mix of science fiction and science fact. And we didn't always necessarily let our readers know which one it was. So if you were reading Mondo in the early 1990s, you got some things that were actually going on. You got the, you know, the beginnings, not really the beginnings because it goes way back to DARPA and so forth in the late 70s, but you got the beginnings of a more popular internet, netted culture. And then you also have stuff like brain implants and, you know, ideas about fully realized virtual realities where you know, you slip on goggles and actually go into computer spaces that you share with people and so forth. And it was very hard to tell or distinguish what we were talking about, whether we were talking about fact or fiction. And we were very much influenced by science fiction. I think Bruce Sterling's statement in Mirrorshades was probably what really inspired us to do the magazine. I'm going to read it. He's talking about science, cyberpunk science fiction. He's writing this in like the late 1980s. And it says, this integration has become our decade's crucial source of cultural energy. The work of the cyberpunks is paralleled through the 80s pop culture. In rock video and the hacker underground, in the jarring street tech of hip-hop and scratch music, in the synthesizer rock of London and Tokyo, this phenomenon, this dynamic has a global range. Cyberpunk is its literary incarnation. You'll notice here that there's no mention at that time of the internet. There's a sense in what he's talking about, the hip-hop, scratch music, there's a sense of the upcoming mashup culture, this sort of syncretic culture of taking materials, taking media materials and hacking them up and recombining them and so forth. But it's interesting that there's no mention of the internet. But we were accused at Mondo 2000 of defining the zeitgeist. Nice German word in the early 90s. And many people felt that we were defining the times, and we certainly were trying to do that. I always thought the most interesting artists were the ones who were connecting directly to their times. I always thought that's what science fiction was trying to do, certainly what cyberpunk science fiction was trying to do. Gibson always said, you know, he wasn't writing about the future, he was really writing about what he was observing now and sort of extending it, as they said in the Max Headroom TV show, 5 years into the future. Our zeitgeist was the zeitgeist of imagination. In the early 90s, when we're talking about what we called cyberculture, it wasn't fully realized. Our reports weren't always about technology that is happening now. We were projecting somewhat into the future, and it was an imagined zeitgeist, and it was really a rather enjoyable be in that culture. I remember we used to have something called virtual reality parties. Did you have those here? So when we were partying about this technology, it still hasn't come into existence. But we had these really sort of raw virtual reality systems at parties in California. You could go and you could stick your head inside goggles and you could move around like through like a weird little office space and stuff like that. And you know, it wasn't that impressive or elaborate, but you could at least get the sense of being inside the computer, being inside a three-dimensional space, and that was kind of exciting. We, Mondo 2000, we wrote a lot about virtual reality, and it was interesting because people came to interview us, and a guy from a German Playboy came to interview us, and he was very excited, and he said that, we are having virtual reality parties in Berlin. I said, have you been in virtual reality? No, nobody's been in. So you can see that it was a zeitgeist of the imagination. It was not as focused on existing technologies as the discussion of cyberculture is now. I think that the new zeitgeist is really about distributedness, decentered attention. It's been described as the long tail. And I'm sure everybody's probably familiar with that. It's kind of a business geek kind of way of explaining the attraction of people to subcultures and to microcultures. And I think in the first issue of Mondo in 1989, I wrote a piece on Andy Warhol. I said, in the future, everybody will be famous to 15 people. And I feel like in the brag about that now, because that certainly has come to pass in the age of YouTube and blogs and so forth, maybe slightly more than 50 people. Did somebody grab that glass of water? Thank you. So anyway, the idea of a zeitgeist, we had a zeitgeist, or we were accused of being at the forefront of a zeitgeist in the early 90s, but the idea of a zeitgeist is that there's a popular culture, right? I mean, in order to have a zeitgeist, there has to be some shared sensibility. The hippies were a zeitgeist in the 60s, punk was a zeitgeist in the 70s, and so forth. The current geek zeitgeist, you know, it's sort of a shared reality among probably lots of the people who are here, among nerds, is really sort of killing the notion of a popular zeitgeist precisely because it is decentralizing media and it's decentering attention, and people are now involved again in microcultures and so forth. So people aren't paying attention to a single narrative, a single idea. We were excited. In the early 90s, we got the sense of movement and action and excitement that was really bequeathed to us by the cyberpunk writers. People like Rudy Rucker, William Gibson, Bruce Sterling, John Shirley, as compared to, say, other writers, Arthur C. Clarke, Samuel Delaney, and so forth, wonderful visionary writers and so forth. The cyberpunks brought the sense of speed and density and a compactedness of the idea that there could be a lot of information in a very small space was, you know, which reflected the upcoming of nanotech, molecular technology, of obviously the microchips, LSD, obviously very compact, powerful technology in a very small space. The feeling of the speed of the music of the Ramones, which now probably seems like easy listening music to people, but at the time that was, you know, the vibe around that.